You're not going to want to miss this episode of the AI Show, where we talk about AML compute, how to save money, how to have good enterprise features, how to be a data scientist without being an IT pro, all of this and more in the next episode. Make sure you tune in. Hello and welcome to this episode of the AI Show. I've got a special guest. Nishank, why don't you introduce yourself?
Hey, Seth. I am Nishank. I work on the Azure Machine Learning team, specifically on Azure Machine Learning Compute.
Fantastic. So I just want to throw this out there. When it comes to machine learning, it's the compute where all of the actual work happens.
Yes.
So I've heard this new term, AML compute. Why don't you describe what it is and why it's so cool?
Yeah, so AML compute is the managed compute offering from Azure Machine Learning. The advantage that we wanted to give with this was a wrapper over the underlying Azure infrastructure so that you are able to spin up your compute, are able to easily scale up clusters, are able to just send your job, and we take care of the rest, which is managing your resources, making sure that all the costs are taken care of, and making sure that all of your logs and metrics are being streamed back, and all of that is just taken care of by AML compute.
And that's awesome because, like, basically, there's a VM somewhere running your things.
Yeah, yeah.
And I don't like doing VM-y kinds of things, yeah. Right? So when we're talking about AML compute, it's a wrapper around the VMs. Is that right?
Yeah, yeah.
So can I ask a couple questions about that? So what kind of VMs can we wrap around?
Yeah, so essentially, we bring you the entire power of Azure Cloud, which means all of the CPUs and GPUs that Azure supports is something that you can use an AML cluster, AML compute cluster out of. In addition, we also allow you to be easily able to get dedicated and low priority clusters, something that our customers really care about, because there are times when their jobs are not high priority and they are spinning up a low priority cluster and saving costs.
So here's another question. So now that you, because when I was hearing this, I was like, AML compute represents like a machine, but it could also represent a cluster of machines. Is that right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So there are a couple of ways to think about it. If you're looking at a dev test workstation, you use something like a compute instance, something that we recently announced at Ignite. Mm-hmm. And then you could also be looking at a training cluster, which automatically scales from 1 to, say, 100 nodes, and it can do distributed training for you. And all that you need to worry about is how your training script is actually going to use something like Horovod to actually communicate between the nodes. But then we are essentially going to go create a VM image. We are going to go deploy the container in it. We'll make sure that all of your data is inside that container and spin off your job, make sure that the communication is set up between those nodes and get the logs streamed back into your cloud storage.
So basically, I get to do all the fun things and you do all the housekeeping.
Yeah, that's
because I'm only interested in running my Python training script,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
The other thing that I have a question about is, like, whenever I'm talking about standing up a VM and I'm in an enterprise, there's always going to be someone that's going to be like, wait a minute, you can't just start up a VM. There's some rules. What enterprise-y-like features do we have that helps with the IT pro side of stuff?
Yeah, AML Compute has been working towards enterprise readiness, and there are a few things that we know that enterprises really care about. There are things like controls. There is things like monitoring. And then there's also things around security that enterprises are passionate about. And today I wanted to just show you some of those updates that we've made to the product and see how it kind of resonates with our enterprise
customers. All right, let's take a look.
Yeah. So yes, here I am on the Azure portal. I have my compute tab open. As you can see that I can go create a new compute if I wanted to. Let's go try that. I'm just gonna spin up a test cluster. And as I do that, it gives me a bunch of options that I can choose from. So in this case, I'm going to go for machine learning compute, which is AML compute. And you automatically see a bunch of options that you get to choose from. There is a CPU and GPU support that we have. You could choose from any of these. In addition, we also started introducing things like VNets that you can now set up in your cluster itself. And that's something that is really interesting for enterprises. In addition, if you wanted to start debugging something on a cluster, you can also set up an SSH account, which you can now pass during your provisioning. And I, as an admin, has access to this account, so I can go into the nodes and actually see what's happening, whereas the rest of the data scientists, if I want to control them from having SSH access, they don't really have access to this.
And that's nice because, like, for example, VNet support is super important because maybe I want to bring it in the workload onto my local premise, on-premises locally, right? And then I want to be able to map that together. But what are some other advantages? Because, like, let me just be honest with you. Like, whenever I create a virtual machine, there is an IP address, and I don't want people to get to that machine.
Yeah.
What are we doing to help with that?
Yeah, so good question, Seth. We have heard feedback that customers do not want a public IP, both on an instance or on a cluster. And that's something that we are going to introduce towards the end of the year. And this was a recent announcement from Azure where services started supporting no public IP policy. And that's something that's going to come out. So we're really excited to work on that and deliver it to our customers.
Fantastic. All right, let's keep going. Sorry I interrupted you there.
Yeah. So in addition, what we started doing was if you're deploying your cluster inside a VNet, we'll automatically close the SSH port for you. You can still SSH into it inside the VNet, but essentially for an enterprise standpoint, we're not going to keep an open port for the internet. Additional things that you can start doing is around monitoring, for example. If you go into the metrics tab, now you can see alerts that you can set up. I'm looking at my resource, which is a workspace, and I'm going to say the metric that I'm interested in is active cores. And I can just change the duration to, say, the last 7 days, and you'll see how easily I can plot this active cores graph across the entire workspace, across the various clusters that were there. So these are things that enterprises can now start using to set alerts on, to be able to monitor exactly how much usage is happening. Is there someone who is abusing the clusters? Are clusters lying idle? Is capacity being paid for but not being used? Things like that.
And this is really cool because as I'm looking at this, look, as a data scientist, I just want to run the thing.
Yeah.
But as IT professionals inside of the organization, especially during enterprises, you want to manage costs.
Yes.
You want to manage to make sure that the machines aren't like insecure. And now we're adding a lot of features to let people do that.
Absolutely. That's cool. Yeah. Let me show you a couple of other things also. So now I'm using our new workspace, which is a data scientist workspace. We announced Studio at Ignite. And as you go here, I'm again on the same cluster. And now I can see what are the various states of the nodes in that cluster itself. But one of the more interesting things you will see here is that now I can actually start listing down the nodes on a cluster. This is a 5-node cluster, but say it was a 20-node cluster, I can easily see what is the state of each node. What is the public and private IP address? If I wanted to SSH into it, you could do that now. You can list the actual runs that are coming on a cluster so you know exactly how many nodes are being used for which run, things like that.
That's cool.
You go to the runs tab. Now you have a nice view of all the runs that are either queued or running on this particular cluster. So you just go through these views and you actually know, okay, these are the various runs that are there. How many number of nodes are these runs actually taking? When were they started? Other tags that you've set up on those runs.
That's amazing.
Yeah, and this view helps not only an admin to understand exactly how the cluster is being used, but also for a data scientist to know exactly which cluster should I use to go submit my job on. Because I got like 5 clusters, but which one's being utilized, which one's not, those are things that I need to make a decision on.
And it might be interesting because you might have a cluster with like an NC6 and some with NC12s.
Yeah.
And if you look at the resource utilization, if maybe you don't need to spin up that huge machine because you're not even using the NC6s, it's a good way to figure it out.
Yes, and one of the things that we're also adding is perf counters here, which means that you'll be able to see your CPU and GPU utilization very soon. And you can do it for a job, you can see it for the entire cluster if you're an admin trying to understand how much of a cluster is being utilized.
And that's cool because, like, just thinking about this, like, for example, I may have set up my estimator wrong.
Yeah.
And it's using only CPU, even though I've stood up a bunch of huge GPU machines. You could be like, hey, we're not using the resources correctly. You can go ahead and change that.
Yeah, and I'll put the icing on the cake. We'll also be pushing all of this data into Azure Monitor, the view that I just showed you.
That's cool.
Which means that you can now set up alerts. So as an admin, I can just rest and assume that whenever somebody is not utilizing my GPU, it's going to throw an alert and I'll actually know who is doing that.
That's awesome. So another question I have, and this I've had this question come up a lot, is how do I grant access to a workspace? I mean, I know that there's something called role-based access security in Azure. What does it look like here?
Cool. Yeah, so when you go to your workspace, just like with any other Azure resource, there's something called identity and access management. You click on this and you try to go give access to someone on your workspace. So in this case, I'm trying to make someone an owner. Say I want to make Seth an owner of this. I'm not sure if I want to do that, but just because we're doing this video, right, I'll try to do that. So I'm trying to add Seth. What is?
Let's do S-E.
S-E?
S-E-J-U-A.
J-U-A.
R-E.
R-E.
Let's see if I'm in there. Oh, maybe I've been fired.
I wasn't expecting that.
That is embarrassing.
Yeah, let me just search for my name. Maybe we are both in the same boat, so this could be our last video. Let's see if I'm able to find myself. I am not. Okay, in any case, in my case, I have already assigned a role to myself, and what I can do here is, if I go to this portal now, you will see that I actually do not have access to creating compute. Somebody has actually applied a role where I don't see a plus new. And this is something that is so powerful for enterprises because they can apply a role, and now going forward, they do not need to be concerned with our customers or their data scientists about creating a compute by a mistake.
That's cool. And so basically what you can do with the RBAC settings inside, or the identity. Let's go back to the portal.
Yeah, let's go back.
And into the access control, you can basically say, here's a user, and here's what they can and can't do inside
exactly.
of the workspace.
Yeah. You can define custom roles. You can say a user can do experiments, but they cannot be doing deployments. And those are all things that you can define against a user in a workspace. So you could have a different identity between workspaces also. But
that's
for
cool.
a particular workspace, we'll now honor exactly what your role definition says and say prevent you from creating clusters.
That's awesome. Because right, you don't want someone frivolously spinning up huge
exactly.
resources and then having to be
yes.
responsible for those particular costs, yeah. which brings me to my next question.
Yeah.
Like, these things can be quite expensive.
Yeah.
Are we doing anything to help manage costs?
Yes. There are a few things that we're working towards. One of the first things that we've kind of already talked about a little bit is that if you are spinning up an AML compute cluster, and I've just switched to my notebook, when you are spinning up a cluster, you actually are able to set in a min and a max node.
Right.
In this case, we just assume that the min node is zero. So this auto-scaling automatically gives you cost savings. And as soon as the cluster is done with its jobs, it's automatically going to spin down. We also allow you to actually configure something called an idle timeout. And this is something that enterprises can use to say, hey, my data scientists actually do a lot of dev test, which means that they keep iterating on their training script before they kind of submit the final script. And they don't want the data scientists to pay this cost of, hey, the cluster went down, now it's scaling back up.
Right.
So give it that idle timeout where it'll wait for a new job for some time before it kind of scales down.
Got it.
In addition, we also have a parameter that you can use in your training script itself, which actually allows you to define, I'm just trying to, there you go. So you have a script run config, which is a run configuration that gets used to define your run. And one of the parameters there is max run duration seconds. So you can say, hey, I want to limit this run to not go beyond 1800 seconds, for example. And this is something that will also be introduced as a policy soon. So as an admin, I can say, I don't want 10-day jobs being run on my clusters because there might be a mistake, but I'm pretty sure my data scientists are not doing that on purpose.
And that's also cool because, like, look, as a data scientist, I want the thing to run forever.
Yeah.
But if I'm smart, I'm also checkpointing my model as I go through each epoch.
Yes.
And it just might be, look, the policy is you can only go for 10 hours, and then I'll just pull the best model out that happens after 10 hours, which is cool.
In fact, there are customers that we've talked to who have scenarios where they want to stop their model training in between, look at the performance of the model, update the hyperparameters, and then again continue the model training or tweak something in the training script. And that's something that you can easily do by just like having parameters such as this, which allow you to control the job instead of having to manually go into the job, inspect it at all times.
That's awesome.
Yeah. Some other things that I did want to kind of mention were also that we have support for low priority. So in this, you can also use a parameter called VM priority, and you can pass it as either dedicated or low priority. And in the case of low priority, what it allows you to do is use Azure's discounted capacity. So all the excess capacity that Azure has, you can get it at a preemptible rate, which is almost at a 70% discount. So it's a steal for GPUs especially, you can pretty much use it whenever you want if there is excess capacity. If a dedicated workload comes into Azure, say a big customer spins up, say 1,000 GPUs, your jobs will get preempted, but when there is excess capacity, you are automatically getting a cost discount.
And that's cool, because maybe you want to run it over like the weekend or Wednesday at 2, and then you'll be able to save a lot of money.
Yeah, Azure also has this functionality of reserved instances where you commit to Azure for, say, using 1,000 GPUs over 3 years. And when you do that, you automatically get about 60 to 70% discount. And that's a dedicated capacity, not even paying low priority price or experience. But now you're trying to save a lot of money by just dedicatedly spending on Azure and like committing to it.
This is awesome. So just to summarize, we've talked about AML Compute. Uh-huh. We've talked about some of the enterprise features around spinning up these kind of resources. We talked about how we're saving costs. Is there anything else you'd like to add?
Yeah, just to, one more thing that we tried to introduce recently was being able to easily share resources between different workspaces.
Cool.
So one of the experiences that our admins kind of wanted was, hey, I have like these 20 workspaces. I have data scientists spinning up and using clusters across these workspaces. It's not easy for me to distribute this capacity. Say I have 1,000 cores. How do I like fair share, or how do I give priority to a workspace which is doing research papers versus someone else who is just doing some dev test experimentation?
Right.
And for something like that, we introduced this experience where you can essentially come into this usage in Quota Blade, and you can actually start seeing the different usages across VM family. So in this case, I have a workspace, and you can see which cluster is using how much. And one of the added advantages here is that now you can also start setting limits on this. So I can say, hey, this workspace, which is a flight delay demo, is not supposed to go beyond a 50 core limit. And once I do that, you will automatically be limiting this workspace's usage to 50 cores. And this is an easy way for you to do something like capacity sharing, governance, and cost management and allocations across workspaces.
That's awesome. So and this is the thing that I really like, because there's aspects of a data scientist's job that I just don't like doing. Like, I don't want to manage a machine. I don't want to worry how much the stuff costs. I don't want to accidentally have like a $3,000 bill at the end of 2 months, So it's really nice to be able to add this governance and this enterprise flavor to these things.
Yeah, the whole point is that we want to take the IT out of data science and leave it with the machine learning compute. And what you focus on is actual dev test experimentation and building your models.
Well, this has been awesome. Thanks so much for spending some time with us.
Yeah, thanks so much, Seth. And we'll try to find you back on IAM sometime.
Fantastic. We'll put some links below on where you can find out more. Yeah. But again, thanks for being with us. Thanks so much for watching. We're learning all about AML compute and all of the amazing features that you have now with enterprise capabilities. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time. Take care.
Thanks for watching. See ya.